Hello and Namaskar. Welcome to the next episode, your most loved talk show, India Bounce Back. I'm your host, Dr. Anshul Dhingra, and I want to really thank all my viewers for your wonderful response. Today, I am really excited and really happy and feeling so honored that I have a wonderful human being and a very special dignitary with us today. I welcome 1984 batch, highly decorated and reputed IRS officer, Satish Kumar Gupta ji. Satish ji, welcome you to India Bounce Back. Namaskar. Thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to have an interview with you. So today, before starting, as a gesture, I want to give an formal introduction. Satish ji is a mechanical engineer from IIT Kanpur. He started his career as IRS officer in 1984, working as income tax officer in Income Tax Department, Government of India. He is recently appointed as member of Central Board of Direct Taxes in the rank of Special Secretary to Government of India, where he will be the member of Taxpayer Services and System, and is also handling additional charge as a member of Income Tax and Revenue. He has played an instrumental role in his last posting as Principal Chief Commissioner of IT in Mumbai. And prior to Mumbai, he was Director General of Investigation for Rajasthan, MP and Chhattisgarh. Welcome once again, Satish Kumar Gupta ji. Thank you so much. Now, the first question for this interview. What I just read is a professional introduction, which people can get it from Google, which people can get it from your professional introduction. But I today want to request you, first of all, that it has to, today this India Bounce Back should be a heart-to-heart conversation. And I want you to introduce yourself to my viewers, yourself. Tell them about your journey of life, your family, your learning, your challenges, your mentor, and your journey so far, much beyond what I have read just now.
I was actually born in Haryana, a small place called Plana Mandi in district Hisar. My grandparents and uncles were in the business of commission agent and grain merchant. And thereafter, my father, he instead of doing business, he traveled to Hyderabad and joined Hyderabad Elvin. And therefore, I had the opportunity of being in Andhra Pradesh in Hyderabad. He was transferred to Punjab. So I have studied in Ropard, district Ropard, near Chandigarh. Thereafter, he was transferred to Jaipur. So I have had schooling in Jaipur as well, in St. Xavier's. And thereafter, I got selected in IIT Kanpur, did my mechanical engineering, and joined Indian Revenue Service in 1984. Prior to that, while waiting for the results, I had worked for 6 months in NBC Bearing, Jaipur, as a manager, and 6 months in Hindustan Levers as in the maintenance management, Mumbai.
Wow.
That is my journey as far as professional is concerned. But somewhere around, the thing which I cherish more is my association with the Chinmay Mission, Vedant. Somewhere around 9th standard, I got introduced to Upanishads, Vedas, and Puranas, and started learning about Vedant, especially Advait Vedant. This got further enhanced when I was in IIT Kanpur. That's a beautiful institution. I would say one of the best in the whole world. It gives a student an opportunity while doing engineering to study humanities subjects. A compulsorily one optional humanity, whichever you want, you can take. But you have to take one compulsorily. So I did about 4 courses in psychology and 3 courses in philosophy.
Oh, wow.
And Western philosophy. So my you can say I am a student of not only engineering, not only physics, but of psychology as well as philosophy.
Philosophy.
And this journey later on continued. And while I was in Bombay, I joined Chinmay Mission. Heard Swami Chinmayanand, Swami Tejamayanand, Swami Krishnottamanand, who is my Guruji, and Swami Dayanand Saraswati, who is associated with Navarsh Vidyapeeth, And when I came to Jaipur, then Swami Brahmaparananda. During entire all this my journey, my parents, especially father, has been my mentor. He has been teaching me, telling me, although he is a man of accounts, but he has been goading me to go ahead, proceed ahead. I would say that I have been quite lucky by the grace of God that I have got a good education in St. Xavier's School, Jaipur, and IIT Kanpur, and come all along this way. I was an avid reader in IIT, in St. Xavier's as well as IIT Kanpur. I must have read huge number of books on not only fiction, but on philosophy, on psychology, on international relation, and various other things.
Wow, good.
So that's my journey. And now then I joined in 84, in 1984 in IRS. Had a training in Mussoorie, IAS Academy and Income Tax Academy at Nagpur. I spent about 8-9 years, initial years in Delhi. From there I went to Mumbai. I joined Commissioner, Additional Commissioner Income Tax in Mumbai. And from there, I went to Gujarat. I stayed about 6 years in Surat, 5 years in Ahmedabad, yeah. Then 2 years in Thane, then Jaipur, MP Chhattisgarh. So I got varied experience in quite a part of India. I've been exposed to a lot of culture, languages, and people. It's been a very nice journey by the grace of God. I'm quite fortunate to have had a good career. And now, next July, I'd be retiring. That's it.
Wow, great, great. What a great journey. And starting from Hisar, now as a family of a business family, then moving to all part of the country, having great exposure. Wonderful. So my next question, many people would like to know when you achieve success. Correct. You become a role model, and you really make people become aspirational like you. So many people aspire to accomplish success or progress the way you have done it. Could you please tell my viewers, what do you think are the top five skills or qualities do you possess which has created all what you have accomplished?
I would say yes. There are quite a few things that a person has to do if he wants to succeed. In how much quantity I have them, I don't know. But I can say that I was a very hardworking person, very sincere, very hardworking, and I was always honest to myself, true to myself as to what I am doing, why I am doing, how much I am doing, how much work I was putting in. And besides that, you have to be humble as well. You have to be humble. There cannot be arrogance in while learning. And most important thing which I learned when I got introduced to Vedas and Upanishads, there's a very beautiful saying. In fact, the entire turn towards Upanishad and Vedas is because Bhavas Bharati Vidya Bhavan publishes a magazine called Bhavas Journal. And that journal in 9th standard, I happened to buy from one of the bookshop. And its motto is interesting. It is from Rig Veda. It says, Ano Bhadra Krito Yantu Vishvatah. Let noble thoughts come to us from all sides.
Wow.
So that has been my motto. Always open, always welcoming thoughts, always welcoming new ideas from books and people. And so hard work, sincerity, honesty to myself, humbleness, and ready to assimilate any idea. Let noble thought come to us from all sides. Ano Bhadra Krito Yantu Vishvatah. This is the motto that of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan I apply to myself.
Wow.
So these are the, let me, I would say the journey was not very easy.
Yes.
Getting into IIT itself is difficult.
True.
Getting into IRS civil services was another difficult thing. So, but I would say grace of God, well wishes of parents, elders, and friends, and hard work, sincerity, all these things.
It all made it possible.
All things make possible.
You cannot
only one thing. All things together make it possible.
So my next question is related to this last thought that yes, the journey is not that easy. It requires a lot of sheer passion, dedication, hard work. The next question, which I would like you to answer, you know, when we reach to a great height, there is a bounce back moment. There will be multiple bounce back moment in life. We see as there's confusion, but still we continue on that path, and slowly that takes the leap, gives us the leap in our life. I want to know, what was that most important bounce back moment in your life?
Actually, I completed IIT Kanpur education in 1982 and joined Hindustan Lever as their management cadre. And that was actually a bounce back moment because I actually had qualified in my placement, I applied in many jobs, and I was determined that I want to go to Delhi only. But Delhi companies, I was not getting through. So, wow. And Hindustan Lever was the toughest thing. So I still applied. Many people told me, no, you don't apply there. That would be very difficult. I said, no, nothing. What is there? I am applying it. Hoga, hoga, nahi hoga, nahi hoga. Jahan mein likha hoga, wahan hoga. So got into Hindustan Lever. That is, three people got into Hindustan Lever out of IIT Kanpur and IIT Delhi, all told together, about 500 people, I got into Hindustan Lever. That wow. gave me a big boost. Yes, I can do something. After about 6 months in Hindustan Lever, I realized, no, I want to go to government and serve people in a different manner. I'm not saying that while being in Hindustan Lever, I would not have served people. I would have, but in a different manner, through government initiative, in a different manner. So I resigned, sat at home, worked hard, and despite several doubts because that was one full year. I resigned in December 82, and my exam was in November 83. So one full year. So lots of doubts. Kya hoga, nahi hoga. These are all competitive exams.
True.
But then here my father helped, his friends helped. They continued to motivate me, and I am here.
Wow.
That was another moment.
Great.
Besides that, I would say once you are in a government service, things are not, there's not much of a kinks in the curve. Things go smoothly. Things have gone smoothly, progressed. But again, it's not that without hard work, without sincerity, without honesty to oneself, you cannot come. So I would say thereafter, these things have helped me quite a lot.
Wonderful. One question which just came in my mind now, like, you know, you said 1982 December, you decided to quit. Then you sat for 1 year in the house studying, and then you, because of that encouragement. But at that time and today, if I compare today, students have more exposure. They are access to career counseling, psychometrics, and so many lot of things. What was the source of motivation? How were you able to get all that kind of counseling or support? Was there, or it was not there?
Frankly, I did not join any coaching class or any counseling class. I did not join, not even for interview. My entire motivation was I have to get through it. I'll tell you an incident that happened in Hindustan Lever which made me quit and which carried me through one full year to prepare for it. In 82, there was, in May 82, I had joined the Hindustan Lever, and there was Datta Samant strike going on in all the mills throughout Bombay. He was wanting much more pay than industry was ready to allow. And there was...
True.
There I saw a police inspector wielding a huge force and controlling people. So there I realized that from there you can make much more difference. Here I'll be making a product.
True.
Whereas there I would be able to make much greater difference in the life of people, in the life of entire there. That once inspector was making it possible whether the industries will survive or not.
True.
Whereas, so in government, we can make much, much greater impact on large number of people if you are sincere, if you are honest, if you are hardworking. So that idea made me quit, and that idea carried me through. Ki nahi, I have to get through. So I got through.
Great. Great. And I really appreciate you for everything what you have done. It's really, really inspirational. Now, moving to the next round of the interview, like making it a little more interesting. This round is called a rapid fire round. So I will be saying one word. And what first word or sentence that comes in your mind, you have to share that. You don't have about. Okay, so here it goes. My first word is India.
It's a great country. I love it so much that the moment I hear about it, out of feelings of patriotism arises in, and India the entire world.
Great. Family.
Yeah, this is a support without which you cannot really go through. Family has been my great support. My wife, my two children. One is a doctor. He is a DM pulmonary in Udaipur, DM lungs. Now he's fighting with the COVID. He's fighting to cure COVID patients in Udaipur.
Wow,
the
great.
Other one is a CA and MBA in New York. Both of them are married. And their spouses are with them. So family is a great support, great help in coming up as well as fighting the stress, day-to-day stress of the job and other things.
Your gurus.
Yes, my gurus. Teachers, yes, they have been fabulous. In school, I frankly don't remember the name, but the one who taught me mathematics really gave me interest for engineering and maths. Then in St. Xavier's, Jaipur, Father Wills Barker, I remember, he is the one who taught me English. He is the one, he was a Christian missionary. Still, we sometimes discussed Vedant with each other. We discussed, he used to talk to me about Upanishads and this thing. So he was a great support. And thereafter in IIT Kanpur, many of them were there who helped me come up. My spiritual guru is from Chinmay Mission, Swami Chinmayanand, whom I met in IIT Kanpur, whom I escorted there. He is the one who has kept me with him, even though he is no more. And his disciple, Swami Purushottamanand, is my spiritual guru who gave me Diksha. So I am basically from Shankaracharya tradition of Advaita Vedanta. And I really beholden to the Almighty that He has given me this field.
Wow. Next word, IIT Kanpur.
It's my life. It is the one who gave me entire thing. Without IIT Kanpur, I cannot even imagine myself anything. It's one of the finest institution in the world. These days, many people like IIT Delhi or IIT Bombay, I'm not saying they are not as good, but IIT Kanpur is the best. It remains the best. It will always be the best because they give huge amount of freedom to the children. They say ki aapko jo subject lena wo lijiye. They give huge freedom to the professors. They can set any percentage as a pass percentage or a fail percentage. They can devise paper where you will get only minus marks and still you excel, you get a grade. See, this is a place where they devise their own subject, they devise their own course, their own curriculum, they give huge freedom to the students. It's a fantastic institution.
Wow, good.
Very well, uncomparable.
Great. Next question, IRS. Next word.
Indian Revenue Service. This is my home. This is my family. All IRS officers, all staff and other income tax officers, they are all my family. I have grown through it over the last 36 years.
Yes.
I have been in this family now for 36 years. It's a great organization. It's officers who are really committed to work. Many people feel that in government, people do not work much. But I can tell you in this service, at least I know people work till midnight. When the times come, last 6 months of the financial year, they are basically the office becomes the home. And they do a pretty good job of collecting taxes. We have when I joined Hindustan Lever, when I joined IRS in 1984, I think we were collecting just about 5,000 crore or 10,000 crore. And in March 19, we had collected almost 11 lakh crore. And despite COVID being there in March, we did a pretty good job of collecting more than 10 lakh crore this year also.
Great.
This IRS is the one which is giving huge amount of revenue for nation building.
True.
And it's doing a pretty good job.
Good. Taxpayer of India.
Taxpayers of India are the nation builders. See, unless they pay taxes, the development cannot take place. The very, very necessary things like even safety of our borders, law and order, providing essentials to the poor people, making roads, infrastructure, nothing can come unless the taxpayers of India pay taxes. I would say taxpayers of India have been paying very, very well. They have been paying despite certain hitches. They have voluntarily pay a good amount of tax. Like I would say, out of 6.5 crore returns we received last year, we do not call more than 0.25% of the people to our office. Not even 1%, 1/4 of a percent. That means 99.75% people we do not even check. So it's a voluntary compliance. That shows that the taxpayers of India are actually doing a very good job themselves.
Great.
0.25% whom we like to scrutinize so that there is a difference for those people who do not want to pay tax correctly. Not for
True.
Everyone. We believe
True.
In voluntary taxation.
Wonderful, sir. Next word is CBDT.
Central Board of Direct Taxes. That is the apex body of this income tax department. It lays the policy, it frames the policy, and is in charge of implementation of tax policy. And it controls, or rather supervises or manages a huge workforce consisting of about 70,000 officers and staff.
Wow.
Spread over about more than 700 cities in the country and collecting about 11 lakh crore of taxes.
Taxes.
It's income tax, direct taxes. It's a very good, very great organization. It's a board which is basically helping the finance secretary and finance minister in discharging the function of collection of direct taxes.
True.
The headquarter of CBDT is in North Block, very near to the office. Finance minister.
True. What is the first word that comes in your mind or sentence regarding MSME?
Micro, small and medium enterprises. These are the backbone of India's Indian industry, I would say. See, they are not only the suppliers to the big industry, they are the ones who give huge employment.
True.
The huge employment is actually generated by MSME. And government has been doing a lot of things for MSME. They have been giving them a lot of benefits. Income tax department also gives a lot of benefits to the MSMEs. And therefore, I would say that a huge responsibility is upon the government people to bring MSME on top for their growth, because the future is MSME. They will give us the jobs. They will
True.
Only give us the jobs and growth.
True. True. Great. And last word about this mission, about this initiative which I've started, India Bounce Back.
It's a very good idea. I think it's a fantastic idea which brings positive stories to the people in this time of COVID, when most people are only copy-pasting the negative stories on social media.
Yes.
There may not be so many negative stories. It is copy-pasting and recycling of the negative stories. That is
negative stories. Yes.
The idea whereby you show that people, there are positive things happening in the country. And I can tell you, yes, the economy has started looking up.
Yes.
People are going back to the jobs. Very soon, I think we will be back to the normal.
True. True. And India will bounce back. Thank you so much for this positive word, sir. Yeah.
Definitely bound to bounce back. Definitely.
Bound to bounce. Yes. Great.
The resilience of the people, the hardworkingness of the people, the honesty of the people, sincerity of the people, India is bound to bounce back. No doubt about it.
Bound to bounce back. Great. Great, sir. Now moving to the round three, it's related to what all we have experienced in last 130, 140 days of this COVID time. So my first question, how these last 130 plus days impacted your life, your work, and what all you have experienced and learned during this time?
Yeah. See, I was in Bombay as Principal Chief Commissioner of Income Tax in March 2020. And the lockdown started somewhere around third week of March. And Finally, on 25th of March, the lockdown happened. And hardly any person was able to go to office. There was a huge amount of fear in even coming out of the buildings. But on 25th March itself, I got my promotion order as member CBDT.
Oh, wow.
Imagine, I was wondering what to do now. How do I go to Delhi and join? All the flights are blocked. All the flights are closed. So I was told you join on email. So I joined as member CBDT on email and continued to work from home for the board as well as for Principal Chief Commissioner Mumbai. So I handled Mumbai tax. Mumbai itself, by the way, contributes over 30% of all India taxes. 32% of India taxes. So I was handling both. And huge gloom stories. People were afraid. Lot of paranoia about COVID had spread. Lot of fear had spread. So there was, God knows, people were wondering what will happen. But I got a good news during this time. On 10th April, I became grandfather. I got a lovely granddaughter.
Wow.
So she came during Corona. She said, what nonsense? Life is there. Corona is not all nonsense. So she is in Udaipur, born to my elder son. So during this thing, then this delivery was to be there as a surgery. So my wife said, no, I have to go to Udaipur. I said, how do we go to Udaipur? You can't go to Udaipur like this. But then we took permission. Because it was emergency, we took permission, went by road, and no traffic at all till Udaipur.
That was also first experience.
no traffic, no other person, no other human being, or even animal or anyone on the road, except me and the border police. That's all. So it was a very nice experience. And when I landed there in Udaipur, I got a call from Delhi that you have to come to Delhi. Can't go back to Bombay because Honorable Prime Minister says that officers must work. They should come and we have to see to it that the government is functioning so that the people get benefits. They are taken care of. So on 14th April, I traveled to Delhi, joined North Block as physically member CBDT. And we worked quite hard during this lockdown. I can tell you there was a lockdown for people, but for senior officers, we all worked overtime in the ministry. All the ministries, the Honorable Prime Minister was really worried about what will happen to the poor people, what will happen to the industry, what will happen to various things. So he said, let us use this time to frame policies to give benefits to the people, to give reliefs to the people. So during this time, we actually worked overtime. Nobody will believe that from 15th April, even though Saturday, Sundays are holiday, I have not seen a holiday. I have been going to my office 10 hours a day, reach office and leave office only at 7:30 or 8 p.m. So there was no lockdown as far as we were concerned. We worked quite hard, worked for the people. It gave us pleasure also that we were working as per the plan of Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Finance Minister, and making out policies to give reliefs. CBDT during this time gave a lot of reliefs and they extended the date of compliances, they extended the date of filing of returns, they also extended the date of payment of taxes, that the interest were reduced. Similarly, various other benefits were given by government and we worked on various policies during this time. So COVID time although it created a lot of disruption in the offices, most of our income tax offices were closed. But during this time, as member system, we worked. I worked very hard, and we saw to it that about 10,000 laptops were distributed among all our offices, which were made compatible for work from home. So during this time, that I think we completed this job somewhere around end of May or beginning of June. We saw to it that all offices got connected through home, work from home. This laptop, see, ours is a very secure net. And giving laptop and entering into that would be very difficult. So we not only got the laptops, we made them, we hardened them. And through VPN technology, able to work from home. So that work was done during this time itself. So during this time, even though our offices were mostly closed, we worked overtime, gave the laptops, and to the people, we gave refunds during this time when nothing else was happening. We gave refunds to the people, and it is recorded that now, of course, as on date, almost 98,000 crore have been disbursed. So about 2.5 million taxpayers got the refunds during these COVID times. So income tax department was working overtime. They were working from home. They were working from office.
Wonderful. Wonderful, sir. So you managed family and then this. Now, this, you know, while discussing with various stakeholders and different decision makers in their own segments, I realized one challenge which every leader like you have faced. Because time ne aisi situation thi, shayad assumptions the ki future kya hoga. Lekin as a leader, I think people like you were having that responsibility because जो आपके सबॉर्डिनेट है वो आपके ऊपर डिपेंडेंट थे कि आप बताएंगे फ्यूचर क्या होगा. एवरी लीडर वॉज फेसिंग दिस सिचुएशन वेयर दे वर ऑल्सो नॉट कॉन्फिडेंट अबाउट द फ्यूचर बट स्टिल दे हैव टू मोटिवेट देयर पीपल एंड अलाइन देम. हाउ यू मैनेज दैट?
एब्सोल्युटली ट्रू. व्हाट यू आर सेइंग इज एब्सोल्युटली ट्रू. इनफैक्ट आई वुड से द गाइडेंस ऑफ कोर्स वाज गिवन बाय ऑनरेबल प्राइम मिनिस्टर एंड फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर, फाइनेंस सेक्रेटरी. बट वी वर्क ओवर हार्ड. वी सेड कि लुक हियर, वी कैन नॉट ड्यूरिंग दिस टाइम इंडस्ट्री इज नॉट फंक्शनिंग. People True. Are not having job, they were not working, and income tax department mein unka refund atka hua hai. So we must give them that refund, we must give them that liquidity.
At least some relief can be done.
Some relief could be done. Not only we gave relief in the form of compliances, filing of returns, payment of taxes, etc., etc., but we said, you know, that is a relief which is not a relief in the hand in the sense that they can use it. Whereas refund, they can use it when they don't have the money. So we over time, we worked very hard everywhere. People were called to the buildings which were closed to harden the laptops. The laptop, you can imagine, we organized teams in 18 states. We have 18 principal chief commissioners controlling entire India. And there we hardened these laptops. We first received deliveries from abroad. Then we hardened these laptops. Hardening these laptops, we made them compatible, and work from home started, and then the refunds flow started to the people. See, that gave a lot of hope to smaller people. To 27 lakh people getting refunds.
True.
It's a huge number.
Great.
And amount is also about 98,000 crores. So that gave a lot of positive relief in the sense they got money in their hand. Most of these were small people, because if you divide 98,000 crore by 25 lakh, you'll come to, it's a very small. So average is itself very small. So we helped the general public of India, general taxpayers of India. Similarly, all the other ministries worked overtime, gave various reliefs to the people. You would have heard from Honorable Finance Minister, so many packages were announced at different times. So we decided, look here, we cannot sit down at home and not work at all. This is the time when the public needs us. We are public servants. This is the time when public needs us. So we had to motivate our workforce. Look here, if the medical staff is fighting, we also have to fight. We are also government servants. We have to do our bit.
True.
So we were fortunately, with God's grace and with everybody's cooperation, we were able to deliver.
Great, sir. And I really appreciate from all my viewers about the great work which as an organization, as an individual, you have been able to contribute. Now, before while I was designing these questionnaire, I did a small survey within my MSME community where different is there across India, and I got few questions which are now specific to Central Board of Direct Taxation similar to that. So I will be taking certain these questions that the current tax system of juggling between. So this was a statement that the current taxation of system of juggling between now two income tax regime may not last long, as Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman ji made her intention clear to simplify taxation by phasing out mostly all exemptions. What are the challenges that arise because of these two income tax regime, and how do you see it?
See, first of all, these are not two different regimes. It is misunderstood in a way.
See, okay,
it is like this, that the earlier taxation continues, that if you want to claim certain exemptions, deductions, then those rates are there. Both taxation rates are there. Now I'll give you another example. See, suppose there is a person whose income is just about 5 lakh, 6 lakh, 7 lakh, 8 lakh, 9 lakh, something like that. Small person. Now he has got a big family and he cannot invest. He gets just about, see, if you get 70,000 rupees a month, you are 8 lakh, 9 lakh.
True.
So that this person, after taxation, he does not have much amount to invest. If he invests, then he is not able to feed people or do his necessary things. So anyway, he was not investing. So we collected the statistics and data, and we found that large number of people who are in the smaller income bracket were not investing because they did not have surplus money to invest.
True.
So why make them pay higher rate of tax? So this is one very beautiful thing that Honorable Prime Minister and Finance Minister thought. Hey, look here, जो छोटे लोग हैं जो वैसे ही invest नहीं कर सकते, उनको हम higher rate क्यों दें?
True.
जो लोग invest कर सकते हैं, उनको हम 10% और 20% और 30% के slab में लेके जा रहे हैं. तो जो इन्वेस्ट नहीं कर सकते उस बेचारे को हम 10% क्यों लगाएं? तो हमने कहा कि ठीक है, इसको हम 5% लगाते हैं. सो दिस सेकंड रिजीम व्हिच पीपल कॉल इज फॉर डिफरेंट सेट्स ऑफ पीपल.
ओके,
इट इज नॉट फॉर दोज पीपल हु कैन इन्वेस्ट. इट इज फॉर दोज पीपल हु कैनॉट इन्वेस्ट, हु आर स्मॉल, हु डू नॉट हैव डिस्पोजेबल इनकम फॉर इन्वेस्टमेंट. सो देयरफॉर द एंटायर बेनिफिट, मतलब इट्स अ पाथ ब्रेकिंग आइडिया व्हिच वेरी फ्यू पीपल वुड हैव, दैट लुक हियर, एक तो 5 लाख तक हमने वैसे ही इनकम को एग्जेम्प्ट कर दिया. उसके ऊपर देन वी थॉट कि जिनकी थोड़ी बहुत ज्यादा है वो बेचारों को हम कहेंगे नहीं, आप 1.5 लाख रुपया पहले ATC में इन्वेस्ट कीजिए, इसमें इन्वेस्ट कीजिए, उसमें इन्वेस्ट कीजिए, नहीं तो आपको ज्यादा टैक्स लगेगा. अब वो बेचारे के पास पैसा तो वैसे ही कम है, उसको वो अगर वो 1.5 लाख कर पाता तो उसको दिक्कत ही क्या थी. वो नहीं कर पा रहा है तो वो किसी तरह से खींच तान के थोड़ा बहुत इधर करता है, थोड़ा बहुत इधर करता है. नाउ वी सेड कि नो, यू एंजॉय लाइफ, यू ब्रिंग अप योर फैमिली, यू गिव देम इम्पोर्टेंट थिंग्स, यू गिव देम व्हाट इज एसेंशियल, एजुकेशन, हेल्थ, फूड, न्यूट्रिशन. सो फॉर दैट पर्पज दिस न्यू रिजीम वॉज ब्रॉट. ही लुक हियर, ओके, फॉर दीज पीपल हु डू नॉट इन्वेस्ट, सो यू कैन पे लोअर टैक्स. नाउ पीपल मिसइंटरप्रेटेड, आई कैनॉट, इफ आई इन्वेस्ट I get less, I have to pay less tax. Arey bhai, this is not for you people. If you can invest, fine, you invest. This second regime is for invest, for those people who cannot invest and still pay less tax. So that paying less tax even without investment.
So in a way, this new regime is encouraging more investment.
This new regime is encouraging more investment for those people who can invest.
Who can invest?
For those who cannot invest, they are able to bring up their family properly without having to bother about investment and taxes.
Okay.
They have to pay very small tax, much lower tax than earlier, and still have disposable income for running the family. So it is basically for that purpose this was brought. And as you say, whether it will continue, look here, the idea is that various exemptions, etc., make the taxation very complicated. So,
True.
Honorable Prime had given her view that we would not like to continue with that. Because even though the higher taxation rate is around 30%, but if you come to effective rate after deduction, exemption, etc., we are now having just about 20%.
Sure.
So people feel that we are having a higher taxation rates. Actually, it is not so. So idea is whether we should have exemption or not, they cannot be done away totally. That is a call which the finance minister will be taking or honorable prime minister will be taking when the time comes. But definitely, I agree that all exemptions, etc., cannot be done away immediately.
True.
Still, this new regime gives an idea that people who do not have money to invest can still pay less tax. So basically, the regime for this, not much more should be read into these things.
Okay, great. Maybe because because we have a huge population and there are a lot of misinterpretation and interpretation based on that. So next question, which was there, was how sure is the CBDT that people will accept the new tax structure announced in the Union Budget 2020 by Finance Minister? I think mostly you have answered, but
because the other regime of no exemption and lower tax is for people who do not have disposable income for investment.
True.
So it has been accepted. It is not really how much we are sure. We are very sure it is accepted because the statistics showed that a large number of people were not investing at all. They do not have money to invest. So why force them to pay higher rate at 10%? Whereas we made it 5%, 7.5% like that.
Great. The next question most talked about these days is how is this concept of faceless assessment is going to impact, and what do you perceive as its challenges and benefits?
See, this is a very, very important. Till now, what happened, there were reforms in the rates of taxation in various substantive provisions. This is the first time that the government has come out with a very, very major reform in procedural. Procedure, and that too procedure of collection of tax, of how do we enforce taxation. So that is the procedure. See, I will just give a small background. In the year 2017, the Honorable Prime Minister asked us to examine and work out a scheme whereby if we can devise a scheme whereby we do not call the taxpayer to the offices. Right. See, a huge amount of time is wasted.
True.
Because they have to come there, and if the officer is already hearing somebody, then they have to wait. So precious time, which is actually a productive time of the day, was being lost. So he said, why not work out a scheme whereby people can submit their information, documents, submission, evidences from home, from offices. So we tried e-proceedings for the next 2 years, from 17 to 19. And in 2019, we floated on as a phase one, faceless assessment. And now on 13th of August, the Honorable Prime Minister announced full-fledged faceless assessment. I'll tell you the feature of the faceless assessment and why it is best, why it is good for everyone, and how it will lead to more collection of taxes without pain. It is basically ease of compliances. Faceless taxation is nothing but ease of compliances, ease of doing business. See, what happens is here, about a large amount of information, we are changing the paradigm of the way Income Tax Department thinks. So before I give the features, I will tell you one more small background. Earlier, department used to get a lot of information. They would remain with the department. The taxpayer would file the return. Then we would say, look here, I have this information. Now I would see what information I had. Then I would issue a notice, you filed return correctly. I don't think you have filed your return correctly. I won't tell what I have. Mm. So department would say, you filed your return correctly. Now the taxpayer didn't know what to do.
True.
What department has. So it penalty, prosecution, et cetera, or litigation. So this mindset is being changed.
True.
What we are saying is we get about 2 crore pieces of information from various transactions made by the taxpayers, by the people. those taxpayer as well as non-taxpayer. And this information we would analyze and we would put everything on the their portal for 26AS. It is part of the e-filing site, 26. Yes. And then yes. They, while filing the return, so suppose next year you when you file the return, you will go and see, are yaar, ye mera dikhaya hua hai, toh let me show it in the return. Mm-hmm. Ye mera dikhaya hua hai, let me show in the return. So now he will remember, are haan, ye meri income hai, let me show this. Let me show this. So voluntary compliance will increase manifold, many fold, because he knows department ke paas kya hai. Woh toh bachega toh hai nahin. Department ke paas hai toh jawab dena padega. Aaj nahin toh kal dena padega. So isliye they themselves will show in the return. Suppose by chance. So this is the first step of voluntary compliance of faceless. I'm explaining you the faceless assessment.
True,
various,
true.
The second step we are saying ki, okay, we will match through the AI, through the data mining, the return parameters and these 26 AS information. Suppose there is a mismatch. We will write a simple letter. Ki, look here, it seems these are the information which you have not taken into account. Please give us a reply. So now I would say that all the taxpayers, all the people should reply, should say whether the information is correct or wrong or partly correct or whatever, and give their response. Now, if it is correct and if it is verified, what we will do is we will simply close. There would be no notices to them. And however, if they don't reply, then there is an issue. Then what, see, two steps we have given them for voluntary compliance. Now, third, what we will do is, now whatever is remaining unverified, we will run it through risk management system, again through machines, through computers. And from there, we would select cases and send it to a verification unit of faceless assessment. Faceless assessment has four units: assessment unit, verification unit, review unit, and technical unit. True. Now, this information will go to verification unit. Now they will again issue notice to the SSC say ki bhai aapne jo jawab nahi diya ya diya tha wo is tarah se theek nahi hai, mujhe ye explain karo. Ab wo explain ho jata, again it is all through faceless, through electronic means. Nobody need to come, nobody would be entertained, nobody would be knowing who is asking. So basically once things are verified, again we close. Those which are not verified, it will be run through a risk management system, and then multiple red flags we will take up for scrutiny. That would be a detailed scrutiny. So in four stages we are handling their information. So we are very sure it will promote voluntary compliance. Now to explain what is faceless portion, see, we have created a gateway called National E-Assessment Center. All communication of the taxpayers are through this gateway. All communication of the department to the taxpayer are through this gateway. Nobody's name is known to the taxpayer, that which officer is handling case, which officer is handling their information. Here, what will happen is the assessment unit will frame a questionnaire depending upon those red flags, and this questionnaire will go through any through this gateway to the public, to the taxpayer.
Taxpayer
who is supposed to answer it on the portal itself. That answer, though, he will upload the information, documents, evidences, etc. That will go to the assessment unit. There, it will be examined by the officer. His senior officer will also examine it. So, two officers, a team assessment. This is team assessment. So, the two people will examine the questionnaire. Those two people will examine the assessment order. Now, that order, when after asking everything, suppose they feel they require some verification, the matter will be referred to verification unit. So they will give them input after verifying. Suppose they require a technical input like what is the case law, what are the legal position, what are various industries doing in this sort of thing, how we should tackle it. So the technical unit will provide the benefit. So now it will be a professional assessment.
True.
And this draft order when assessment unit makes, it will be run through a risk management system again. This risk management system will throw out cases which require to be reviewed. Now, this risk management system is designed for two purposes. One, that whatever is to be taxed should not escape. Number one, the officer should not make a unnecessary tax demand. They should not make unnecessary addition to the income and levy taxes on that. So we are preventing both leakage of tax as well as wrong taxation. This risk management system is designed both ways for the benefit of the SSE, so that it doesn't have to go to litigation, doesn't have to suffer at all. Now, once this case is caught up in the review, now this review unit would be in a different city. See, first of all, the assessment unit, suppose you are sitting in Gurgaon and it is your case which is to be assessed. Now, this case will not be assessed in a unit of Haryana or a nearby state. Your case is likely to go to south or east or west somewhere. But so the officer will be sitting in some other city, not in your city, definitely. And this review would be in a second city. Suppose your case was handled in Chennai. Okay. Now this review is likely to be in Calcutta. So another two sets of officer, so that there is no bias, so that there is nobody can contact them. There is a total no interface at all. Now in this review, suppose nothing comes out, then the assessment order will be passed. But suppose review officers, again, there is a team, the officer and his boss, suppose they feel ki no, they have not seen this thing, or they have done this thing wrong. Either way, either they have not seen this thing, it should have been more tax, or they say, wrong tax has been levied. So either way, if they differ, this case will be referred to a third unit in a third city.
Oh, okay.
Go to a third city. And the officer finalize that who is right, whether the first officer is right or the second officer is right. And they will finalize the assessment order. So you can be sure that we are making so many safeguards that there is no wrong assessment. There is no wrong done by any officer, so that the taxpayer suffers. Simultaneously, we are also taking care that if there is a genuine case where tax should be levied, it is levied. Minimum 6 sets of officer in 3 sets of proceedings would be seeing if there is a taxation. So wow. I would say that it is faceless, because in the first city nobody knows who are the officer handling. In the second city where there is a review, nobody knows who are handling. In the third city where it is being finalized, nobody knows who are handling. Of course, the officers can see from the return who are the taxpayer, but they are sitting in different cities. And
true.
Then it is not, they are not finalizing by second sets of officer.
True.
So it is actually a case where there is no interface. There will not be possibility of any wrong thing being done by taxpayer, wrong thing done by the tax officers. So it's a very good scheme devised, and we are, it's a new scheme. We have already done about 11,000 cases in this. In the first phase, we had taken a 58,000 case. We have completed 11,000 by now. So we are sure that this scheme will succeed. We have expanded quite a lot. There would be a few issues of posting people, etc., etc. It will be tackled. I am sure it will be a great success. And during this COVID time, a great thing has been passed on to the citizen, that without coming into contact with the tax officers, they can do their compliances. Yes.
They can do their compliance. I think that's really a wonderful initiative, I must say, and a very hopeful initiative, with a great hope get executed in the right way. Don't you think, the initiative is there, great initiative. Don't you think educating, I think, from both ends, education to both the taxpayers absolutely, and to this
absolutely,
is a very, very important.
Absolutely. We have already done about 100 webinars with officers as well as with taxpayers, with chartered accountants, with tax practitioners, industry. On this Friday itself, I was addressing SOCHAM, and our finance secretary was addressing Vicky, and our principal chief commissioners have been holding this thing. We are going to further do, in fact, in-house training we'll be doing for our officers and staff. For outside also, we will be holding lots of seminars and webinars, etc. We definitely, I agree, there is no choice, but we have to do training to our people as well as outsiders. They have to learn how to submit the response online, and a response which is self-explanatory. Since they cannot for explanations, it will be self-explanatory. Although, we have kept a provision for video conferencing wherever required. But it would be used very, very scarcely in situations we would be outlining. So it's not that we are not going to permit any very complicated thing, we will definitely have video conferencing, maybe while recording statement, maybe while recording giving cross-examination or some such thing. But definitely, it's a very well thought out scheme. But the success depends upon people, success depends upon taxpayers, success depends upon tax practitioners, success depends upon our officers. So I request through your medium, everyone to please come on board. It is your scheme. It is everybody's scheme. It is for everybody's benefit. And it is the future, because technology cannot be wished away. Technologies cannot be wished away.
True. Just one more challenge, sir, which I foresee now while having this discussion. Litigations will arise more in this kind of a scenario or not? What?
Because actually, if you had heard my statement a few minutes back properly, there would be very little litigation. What I said, we have devised a review system whereby if a person has made an addition which is not warranted, then it will be flagged by this review team and decision will be taken by third person. What is correct.
True.
So there would be much less litigation in this, because there would be there would be hardly any addition with which a person will say, no, okay, I don't agree.
Okay, so great.
So there would be very little litigation in this. But you would, on the other hand, you would agree that if some person has not shown the correct income, he is supposed to pay correct taxes, his income is required to be assessed. I would say you would agree with that.
Yes, 100%, sir. 100%. This has to be in the right way. Yes.
It is the due taxes which serve the people.
True.
Infrastructure. Our armed forces, our police, everyone. The whole civilization is dependent upon taxes.
True. You rightly mentioned about using the data intelligently, and you from what are the plans of CBDT as of now to use the technology data analysis? Already you have mentioned this, and how this data mining and artificial intelligence game changer, will it bring more people in the tax net, or will increase the taxpayers in the country?
Yes. I would say we are getting about 2 crore pieces of information at present from various sources, which includes various expenses, purchases, and banks and other places. Now, this data mining is being done to organize this information. And then this information is being filtered, and that is being kept on 26 areas. So, If for example, suppose you have traveled to US and you had not shown made this expenditure outside your books, so definitely, ye meri jo trip hai, ye mere bank mein se honi chahiye, to withdrawal dikha do ya kuch kar do, something like that. You will definitely show that. And we are getting this information not only of taxpayer but everyone. So it will increase the net. It will increase the taxpayer net. It will widen the tax base. This technology we are using, it is humanly impossible to really use these 2 crore pieces of information. It's humanly impossible.
Yes.
We are using technology for data mining and AI also. We are going AI. To learn as one very interesting thing. This now with this technology, I will know which are the companies connected, which are the individuals connected to you through your date of birth, through your father's name, through your mobile, through your email. If anybody has used, we will know that person is connected to you. So I'm sure we will be able to increase the tax net as well as we'll have a better compliance. Increase the tax.
Wonderful. So to all my viewers, now be serious and come and make more and more people come in the tech stack. It's a benefit of the company, benefit of the country. So my next question, you already answered, but still it's a part. Are you really confident, sir, that India will bounce back? You already mentioned India
bounce back. It has got a huge resilience. And I can tell you one thing, in the last figures collected of GST, it is 86,000 crore, which is almost 80% of the normal. So that shows that people are already working quite a lot. the income tax is also just minus 20%, and that is because given rate cuts in September, October, if you recall, madam had given rate cuts.
Yes.
So if you account for that, we are collecting what we collected last year. So India will bounce back, is bouncing back, and India will bounce back. The people here are very hard work, very sincere. It's a great, the Indians are really great people. No doubt about that.
Wonderful, sir. My next question, being a strong contributor, an observer, and an influencer right now, where you see industries and country moving toward a revival, what role do you feel you are going to play in the new normal?
No, we are playing a huge role. See, taxation is part of the businesses, ease of business. See, by doing this faceless, by not calling people to the department, by not wasting their time, we are contributing to ease of compliance, number one. Number two, during these difficult times, we have given huge amount of reliefs in terms of compliances, in terms of dates, by reducing the rates of interest. So even CBDT is absolutely intermingled with all other ministries, with all other industries, in making life very easy. So ease of business is one of the very, very important to us, and that is how we are working.
So, Anita, my question was a little different. My question was, what role do you feel Satish Kumar Gupta ji will be playing as a new member of CBDT and moving forward?
This faceless assessment has been piloted by me, by my team, and with the guidance of Chairman CBDT, Finance Secretary, Finance Minister, and Honorable Prime Minister. Now my job is to make it work. Nuts and bolts are remaining. The nuts and bolts are remaining. The scheme is there. Nuts and bolts are remaining. So I will be very totally entangled in the whole thing and giving that.
Wonderful. Now my last question, moving ahead to the closure of the interview. What will be your top three advices to the taxpayer of the country?
I would say that as taxpayer, they are nation builders. And they should therefore positively think in terms of contributing to the country, contributing to the growth of the people, paying correct taxes by showing correct income. One more thing, I think that these days in the times of technology, all the information flows and they are with their department. So it is advisable that they see their 26 AS. It is advisable that they reply to all our letters, communications. Because non-compliances create problem, non-compliances lead to some adverse inferences. So I would suggest that many times taxpayers give the emails of their CAs or other members of family or other relatives. I would suggest that in returns, they should give their own emails, own mobile numbers, so that they are able to see exactly what has happened, what is required to do, along with maybe CAs also. But they should give their own, and they should pay correct income and pay correct taxes, do the compliances as soon as they are asked for, reply properly and reply very clearly and self-explanatory submissions. That is all my request to the taxpayers.
What will be your top three advices to the non-taxpayers?
The non-taxpayers, I would say they should not be afraid of the present difficult times. Yes, they should take a lot of care. They should wear masks wherever they go. They should have distance, social distancing. But please do your businesses. Please do your jobs, everything, because we cannot keep on be away from the work.
True.
This corona is going to stay. We have to learn to live with it. But we must take adequate care by social distancing and do our job in a normal manner. I'm sure they should realize that the country is progressing, the country government is doing everything for, and they should also now start working without fear and without any fear. Same thing, they should work, they should call the all their workers. See, they have to take care of the workers during these difficult times. They should not leave their workers simply on to themselves. If the workers do not survive, the SMEs cannot survive.
True.
So they must basically bring them, they must give them jobs, they must go ahead and do start productions to the best of their ability as soon as possible and as fast as possible.
Great. Thank you so much, Satish Kumar Gupta ji. This was really, really insightful. And I'm very hopeful that all the viewers will get a lot of encouragement, right insight about which we discussed today. It was really, really a great interview. Viewers, if you have any question which is still you would really want to ask or anything, you can post it in the comment below this YouTube. And I will certainly try to ask Satish ji about it. And if possible, thank you so much. India will bounce back. Stay tuned for the next episode with another great important dignitary. And we are really, really thankful to Satish Kumar Gupta ji once again, sir, and wish you all the best for your new responsibility as a CBDT member. May God bless you with success, with happiness, and now good news in your family. So enjoy a little time to enjoy with the new ones. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir.